Hello, everyone, and good evening. Welcome to tonight's webinar, Planning Ahead for Your Family's Legal Needs. Hopefully, you have had the opportunity to review Planning Ahead, Estate Planning, and State and Federal Benefits, which are pre-recorded workshops that will help prepare you for this one. Without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Bhavik Patel.
A little background. My name is Bhavik Patel. I am an attorney at Sandberg Phoenix, and I specialize in special needs planning, special needs trust, public benefit eligibility, and estate planning, and sort of that entire universe. And I have been giving these workshops for well over a decade now, and I've done well over a century of them, I guess, over 100 of them. But this one is a first of its kind. It's something we were just expanding upon. Really, any question that's on your mind around your estate planning, public benefit, special needs trust, any of that, consider this sort of free legal advice. You know, you can get some guidance on that. I'm going to sort of set the stage a little bit today. I don't have PowerPoint slides or anything like that today. Again, encouraging some Q&A to the extent you have questions. But here are a few things I do want to kind of cover from a presentation perspective. And I'll kind of give you sort of the roadmap. First things first, I want to talk about how to get help and who is out there to help you in terms of a team of people that are experts in this area. And what I see as sort of the type of advice and help you can get that kind of covers all aspects of your family's needs, and in particular, when you have children with disabilities. And so, you know, first things first, an attorney, obviously, but one that specializes in special needs planning. And this is a very important thing. So many attorneys are generalists, which is perfectly fine, and they do a very good job. But there are particular areas of the law that require a very specific level of depth and specialty and experience. And special needs planning is one of those areas. And so seeing a generalist, someone that does general practice, and asking them to do special needs planning, that's fine if you feel comfortable with them, but you might want to ask them to what level of experience do they have dealing with public benefits, estate planning, special needs planning, special needs trust, those types of things. A general rule of thumb, I would say, is someone that is spending a good third to a half of their practice in the actual area that you need their help, that probably gets them to a some deeper level of understanding and know-how. That is where you need to be. If you've asked a friend that's an attorney to prepare a special needs trust, something along those nature, you'd be surprised. And I'm not trying to scare anybody or to say people aren't doing a good job. But I review many, 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 many thousands of people, special needs trusts, and some that were drafted by their family that's a lawyer, or some friend that they know, or some generalist. And it's amazing to me how many of those special needs trusts are done inaccurately.
I'm sorry, we have a question, and I think it's a good one. And it's, how do you get started? So where do you look for a special needs attorney? Do you go to the Missouri Bar Association? Do you Google? What do you do?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I think Googling is fine as long as you get a chance to interview the person, like that you actually meet with them or have a call with them and ask them what their expertise is and ask them how much of their practice is in this area. But Google is an effective way to at least get a list of names. That's not my preferred way because Google is very scary, in my opinion. And the winner is whoever paid the most money to do the search engine optimization in their coding on their website to pop up first, not necessarily someone that doesn't need to do that kind of concept. So just be wary of that. But again, you know, it's a great starting point to Google. Obviously, I'm a little biased here, but one of the ways I would recommend is to go to other experts and ask for them. So financial advisors, CPA firms, if you have advisors like that in your world that's helping you, asking them for special needs planning experts is a great way. But then also relying on the organizations that actually do this for a living. St. Louis ARC, for example, has already done a lot of your vetting for you. In fact, I don't know, when we used to have these workshops live, I think you handed out a actual hard copy material of a list of several attorneys that are in the St. Louis area that I think are vetted out, that you've heard feedback from other members of ARC that have had good experiences and so on and so forth. And so that is a great way, is to ask Anne and Brianne to send you, I think you have that in a format that can be emailed. Is that correct, Anne?
I absolutely do. And it has a list of attorneys. It includes Bhavik, but it also includes other attorneys. And it's not a standalone list. So if that's something that gets you started, but you want to look further, you sure can.
Absolutely. And we've got some really good questions on this topic. So this is perfect. This is exactly what I wanted. So this is a good audience, I can tell. So does most attorneys charge a flat fee or an hourly fee? You know, that's a really great question. I would say it is trending more and more towards flat fee. But if I was to answer that technically, I think most people probably still do hourly. But you really want to consider someone doing a flat fee. Like, to me, that's the trend. To me, that is providing you price certainty. And it's encouraging you to not look at your watch when you have questions that you want to ask, or you want to have another meeting to sit down and review the documents that have been drafted for you. In other words, you can go in deeper with your curiosity, you know, and your review of the documents. Make sure you really understand the mechanics of the documents, how it works, what you're supposed to do. And a lot of times when you're looking at that clock or you're calling that attorney and you just had a simple question and then you got a bill in the mail, that can be frustrating. And it's just uncertain, right? And people want to budget for this. You know, getting special needs planning work is an absolute must. And that, look, it don't matter if any of you call me or hire me on it. I'm just trying to be very direct with you. It is a must. If you have a loved one with a disability, you must do special needs planning. So I would seek out flat fee, in my opinion, because it's more encouraging for a deeper conversation. Can you negotiate fees, or are they set in stone? I mean, I think that's a per attorney type of question. Some might be willing to give a break in fees. Some might say, listen, I would love to, but I can't. You know, we represent 1,000 clients a year, let's say, on this. And if I make deals here and there, and all of a sudden it's a small town. So some people do all over the place. But you should feel empowered to ask. Nothing wrong to ask. Again, that's just better information you're getting that gives you the feel of whether this is the right type of person, attorney, to work with. Because this is an intimate thing. Estate planning, special needs planning. We're talking about your family, your loved ones, your assets. You should feel comfortable with who you're working with. Are payment plans typical? Yeah. You know, I mean, I can't speak to other lawyers, but I am happy to take a payment plan. I always, in these presentations, I always call the child with a disability Joey. So Joey's like a term of art now. I've been using Joey for a long, long time. I care about Joey, just be honest. That's where the passion comes for me. Someone just asked, so what typically happens when you call an attorney? Even making the call makes you nervous. And like, what is the reception going to ask me and so on? At what point am I going to be charged? So here's the thing. You are the customer. And I want to give you like a badge, you know, and consider yourself deputized. You're the client. You're in charge. Now, I understand the nervousness. What I would say, and feel comfortable asking, are you willing to sit down and meet with me and understand me and my family's needs and objectives? And I would like that. I would like to see if this is a good fit. So would this initial consultation be a fee, or is it going to be a free consultation? That is an absolutely acceptable question. And then you know how they respond and you get to decide what you want to do. What I can tell you is, you know, I do a lot of special needs planning in this area in St. Louis. I meet with every special needs planning client I have. And I don't charge for that initial meeting. And I think a lot of attorneys probably give that initial consultation for free. So don't feel nervous to ask that question. And then once you get to that meeting, it's kind of like a first date. You know, you're kind of trying to feel like, how comfortable are you with this attorney? Are they answering your questions? Can you kind of relate? Are they speaking to you in a way that helps you understand what's going on? You know, just like you would make any other decision, you're kind of trying to feel out that. And once you know and you feel comfortable, you don't need to go out and interview 20 other people. I mean, just feel good about it. Get the job done, you know, go ahead. If you call the receptionist or anything, what are they going to go ask you? I mean, they might ask you for your name and your address. This is perfectly normal. You're okay to give that information. Law firms, when they get clients, they have to enter into their system whether there are any legal conflicts to represent that client. So we need that name and phone number and address so we can enter it into our system to make sure we can represent you if you decide you want to hire us. And that's called checking conflicts. That's just lingo that you might have heard in the past or unaware of. I wanted you to not be surprised by that. And by the way, now in today's world, virtual versus live meetings. You know, something to ask. If you're someone that prefers one over the other, ask when you're setting up that meeting, can we do it virtually? Can we do it live? Some attorneys have their styles. And again, it's a fit thing. So you need to kind of make sure. If you weren't comfortable with an attorney that initially did your estate plan, just didn't vibe with them, can you just take those documents to a new attorney to review, revise, update a couple of years later? Absolutely. Just because some attorney drafted the documents doesn't mean you're stuck with them in perpetuity. You are the customer. Just like you go to a restaurant and then next week you didn't like that restaurant, so you want to go to another restaurant. I mean, absolutely. And I really want you to feel empowered, as you probably do on all kinds of advocacy level for your loved one. This is no different. Advocate for Joey, you know, and if you're not feeling the vibe with one lawyer, go find another one. What question should I come into the meeting with? One, I would ask, how comfortable are you in the special needs trust area? How much special needs trust work you do? How do you continue to enhance your skill set or your knowledge in this area? That's another good question. Has any of your special needs trust ever been audited by Social Security or Medicaid? How did that turn out? That's a very good question to ask. Do you understand the public benefits? Here's a fun one I always say. Ask them what the POMS are. Just say that. What's the POMS? POMS. But what's the POMS? If they look at you not knowing what that means, that is absolutely 100% the wrong attorney to work with. The POMS, by way of background, so you know, it's sort of the governing regulatory rules that are like the internal memorandum for Social Security and to follow for certain public benefit eligibility. And so if they don't know what POMS means, that means they've never dug into it. They never dug into it, then they don't have that skill set, in my opinion. So that's a really good question. If you're starting to really feel it, and then all of a sudden they don't know what POMS are, that's kind of a thank you very much. Appreciate your help. Move on to the next person, in my opinion.
Is it ever too early to secure an attorney?
I mean, no one's crystal ball works. So when's it too late is probably the more appropriate question. And well, when you become incapacitated or when you die, it's too late. And anyone knows when that is, then any time before then is acceptable. So obviously tomorrow is not promised to any of us. That's the saying or something like that. I probably butchered it. But tomorrow is not too early. You know, I hate to give that sort of cliched answer, but honestly, you could have a 2-month-old or you could have a 46-year-old. And neither one of those are too early. And your estate planning addresses so many aspects of family, and the special needs planning fulfills so many aspects of a child with a disability. You're Joey. So it's all contingency planning. It's for the what if, what's going to happen. And if you're someone that likes to be proactive and wants to get sort of that covered so that there are no surprises, then it's not too early. But meet with these attorneys, interview these people, ask them what the flat fee is or whatever, ask them if they'll do an installment, get planned for it. Economic realities are a true thing. And if you find out something's going to cost X, well, maybe you need a plan for that. And so maybe like anything else in life, right? You might need to wait till you can do it, which is a reality. And we all are just being asked to do the best we can. That's all. There's no judgment in it, you know? And so I guess that's my answer.
Well, it was kind of meant to go that direction just because I work a lot with families who have older adults, and some of them still don't have their plans in place and they're very stressed about it. And I know that they would tell younger families to not wait.
Yeah.
I know that would be your advice. Fair.
Any suggestions for finding an attorney for an individual with disability who commits a crime? Their comprehension of the law is different than neurotypical individuals. Yeah. You definitely need to see a criminal lawyer. I believe any criminal lawyer is going to be able to use the incapacity / disability as a defense in whatever crime. So it's not necessarily the special needs expertise piece of it for the criminal law side, it's the crime. So you need to find a lawyer that specializes in that particular crime. Some criminal lawyers don't deal with like capital crime, murders, rape, things like that. Some only do white collar crime or tax evasion or, you know, so just like anything else, you're just like what doctor you go see, you need to find the specialist in that area. But that defense is something that I think anyone that's an expert in that area is going to be able to use, because that expense is a pretty general defense.
There is also an organization called Options for Justice, which specializes in working with individuals with disabilities who have gotten into the criminal system. And they serve St. Louis City and St. Louis County.
Is it typical for attorneys who specialize in special needs planning to also specialize in estate planning, so they can do the special needs trust and our overall estate planning together? It would be perfect if that's the case. So estate planning is the big bubble. And inside estate planning is special needs. I would say everyone that's a special needs planning expert can do the estate planning, but the opposite is not true. Not all estate planners subspecialize in special needs planning. So asking if they do estate planning is great, but you need to go on deeper and ask if they really specialize in special needs planning. Now, backing up, most special needs planners really do know how to do the estate planning. So if you're really wanting to sort of create efficiency and have, you know, everything sort of connected without dealing with two different lawyers, which dealing with one is already enough, so dealing with two would be even more. Just my guess, the hope would be you find a special needs expert and then they can do the estate planning for you. There probably aren't any law firms that do family law like prenups and divorces and estate planning and special needs trust. So no one-stop shops. That would be so much easier. That's not true. I mean, Sandberg Phoenix, I mean, I don't plug myself. Sandberg Phoenix has a family law team, has a special needs planning team, and has an estate planning team. Under one roof, one-stop shop, but you still want the efficiencies of the expert that does family law work all day long to do the family law stuff while you have the special need. You don't want someone that doesn't do it all day long preparing a document they're not used to preparing. So it'll just cost more. It'll take more time. So lots of firms have all three of those divisions or expertise in-house. So you can still create that efficiency that I was talking about. That's not that uncommon. If you get a divorce after a special needs trust is created, do you need to have the attorney who helped create the trust review the divorce papers to ensure the divorce does not affect the trust? What a great question. So family law attorneys are family law attorneys. They handle the divorce. They are, in my opinion, not special needs trust experts or special needs planning experts, nor are they estate planning experts. So when you get a divorce, there's two certain things. You almost certainly are going to have to redo your estate plan, because if you had one before the divorce, it very likely had you having your spouse do this for you, you leaving your assets to your spouse, you get divorced. I'm going to guess you don't want your ex-spouse to be in control of things and you don't want your ex-spouse to receive things. So on an estate planning front, you definitely need to talk. On the special needs trust part, here's the one of the biggest things I'm seeing, and we're having to come in and clean it up, and it's costing clients a lot of money for us to come in and clean it up. I would rather you know this, proactively deal with it, and not have to come see us to clean it up, because it just costs a lot of money to clean it up. And I don't really want to do that work. And no one's happy about having to pay me a lot of money to clean up something. Here's the number one issue in a divorce. Child support is usually determined through the divorce process. And there's a child support order that says how much money is owed for the benefit of the child. In the divorce, you're going to debate and negotiate on, does that continue forever because you have a special needs child? Is this going to last till 18? You're going to vet out all of those issues. Some are going to last till 25, 30, whatever. But after your child turns 18, that child support payment is going to be deemed income to that child. And it's going to actually reduce to potentially disqualify the child from receiving public benefits. And there is a workaround to that, a proper way to do it. And that is when you're negotiating the divorce and the child support, but there's a particular, a unique type of special needs trust that can get created in which the child support payments can go into. And those payments go into that trust, then your child will not be disqualified from public benefits. So something that simple, And then we have to come in and modify the divorce decree and the child support order, create the special needs trust, and ask the judge to agree to it. And that's assuming the mom and dad are on the same page, you know? And so getting it done through the divorce is going to be the most efficient, effective way. So that was a really long-winded answer about the divorce question. But we have seen, and we clean up at least 2 to 3 dozen of these a year. And it just, it costs money, like sometimes $5,000 to $10,000 in fees. Because you got to go to court. If the parties don't agree, you can understand. It's like almost like another mini divorce at times if it gets really nasty.
So Bhavik, then do the two lawyers need to talk to each other? Is that how it gets worked out between the special needs lawyer and the divorce lawyer?
I could tell you this. A lot of times they don't even know to bring it up. The two divorce lawyers, you know, mom's lawyer and dad's lawyer, they don't even know. They're not, this is not on their radar. And I give presentations to the Bar Association, the Family Bar Association, to try to educate the divorce lawyers that this is an issue so that they can be better prepared when they find this out. But I mean, there's so many divorces and so many lawyers that do that work. Most of them do not know the unique nature of this special needs trust and to maintain public health. They don't even understand public benefits. So I really think if you have a child with a disability and you're going through a divorce, you should encourage your divorce lawyer to talk to a special needs attorney, or you should talk to a special needs attorney and connect them with the divorce lawyer so that they can tell them what to do. And then the special needs trust lawyer can prepare the trust that's needed. And then the divorce lawyer can do the rest instead of us cleaning it all up at the back end. It's just a lot messier. What are the drawbacks of having a bank serve as a trustee of a trust? Well, first of all, I love having banks serve as corporate trustees of a trust, especially a special needs trust, because special needs trusts have to be administered in special ways. That's how you get the benefit of a special needs trust, which is allowing assets to go in there, but not disqualify Joey from the public benefits he or she is receiving. And if you don't administer it properly, you could disqualify Joey from public benefits. All the assets in the trust can now be used as a way to disqualify Joey. So having a bank that specializes in trust management, they would know those rules. Now the downside though, that's the real question you ask. What's the drawback downside? It costs money. You got to pay a fee for a bank to serve as a trustee. Now, you can name individuals and charge them fees as well. I mean, they can also ask for a fee, but a lot of family members don't. So it sometimes is a cost thing. But if you don't administer it right and you lose public benefits, well, that costs something too. So it's kind of a balancing act. How large of a trust does a special needs trust have to be in order for the bank to be the trustee? They probably have significant fees. So it's all over the place. I will say, you know, your bigger banks are going to want at least a couple of $1 million in the trust, but smaller banks will do it at a couple hundred thousand. There is also some other types of special needs trust called the Midwest Special Needs Trust, which is sort of a quasi-governmental, quasi-not-for-profit company that will do it, and it will do it with no minimum. They do charge some fees. They're not extraordinary, but they do take lower amount trusts. There's a lot of other pieces of that that I won't detour in, but we do have them come in from time to time, ARC does, to talk about their trust and its I mean, I think their average special needs trust is like $10,000. I mean, that's the sort of the space that they really cover and serve is sort of this really sort of smaller, like less than $20,000, $30,000 special needs trust. That's kind of their beautiful spot in that world, but they can do more too. It's just, you have to know some of their other nuances, which when they come in, you should go to that workshop and ask them fee structures and other things like that. I've heard of nightmare situations where professional guardians stole from or otherwise used misappropriated funds for them. Please talk to this. Nightmare situations exist anytime you have any individual in charge of something and has access to money. That's sort of an unfortunate comment. It is unfortunately a reality that bad actors exist. It is rather rare. We only hear about it because we only hear about the bad stuff. But one potential checks and balance would be to have the guardian be a different person than the trustee of the trust. So the guardian's taking care of the well-being, the health, the living decisions for Joey. The trustee manages the money. So you have checks and balance. And to me, if you got two different roles in that, that might be a very easy button in trying to create an oversight and accountability for both roles so that there's no funny business going on. So if I find out that my older brother, who is a special needs trustee for Joey's trust, is misusing the funds, who do I even report that to? I am not the trustee, he is, so how can I report the misuse of funds? Who pays for the attorney fees then to right that wrong? Me, since I brought it to light, or would my older brother have to pay these fees? Okay, so the fee part, let's answer that part first. There is no hard, fast rule in our law, in our legal system. But if the bad actor is found to be a bad actor, it is not uncommon that the bad actor would pay the fees. However, the type of lawyer you hire, there are two types. There's what we call a contingency fee lawyer or a pay as you use lawyer. And you know, if you don't have any money, but you have good facts that might show that there was money that's being used, you could hire a contingency lawyer to try to go after and recoup the money. And then let's say your brother stole $100,000 from this trust and you were successful in your lawsuit, then maybe that lawyer that you hired gets a percentage of what you recovered. So the $100,000 would go back into the trust, but $30,000 of it might go pay the lawyer, like a 30% fee, versus paying someone hourly. Then you would have to pay, and then you'd have to ask for the court for the trust to reimburse you if you're successful. Who do you report it to? You could, if there was some kind of like financial abuse kind of thing, you could try to report it to the police, a theft. So just like any other theft, you could file a report, go to the police. 99% sure that they're just gonna say this is a civil matter. They're not gonna pursue it criminally. And then you're in the judicial system. You would have to file a lawsuit on behalf of the beneficiary saying that there's misappropriate use of the funds in the trust. If you can't pay for that, then probably finding a contingency lawyer is probably your route. A lot of the law firms that you see on billboards, for example, would be what contingency fee lawyers are. Then how could I be named as the trustee since he failed in his duties? Well, you go to court. One of the requests would be to remove him as trustee and have a court order that replaces him. That replacement could be you, could be a corporate trustee, it could be a completely different party. A lot of options there potentially. Depends. You're in litigation. I mean, just so you know, if you're in litigation and you guys can't reach an agreement amongst the parties, you're looking at 18 months probably before a resolution. And if it's a contingency fee, that's one thing. If it's not, you're probably looking at 100,000 plus in fees, legal fees. What are the next steps if a trustee misuses the funds from a special needs trust? There is no direct answer to this question because it depends on the circumstance. Also depends on the trust document. But generally speaking, you need to probably, if that is what is happening, you need to probably engage what I call a lawyer, but I'm going to give you a specialty there. And in my world, they're called fiduciary litigators. These are people that specialize in trust litigation matters. Sandberg Phoenix has a fiduciary litigation team, for example, and whenever we have a beneficiary that has trouble communicating with the trustee or thinks that there's funny business going on with the money or some money's disappeared and accounting doesn't balance, whatever, we shift it over to our fiduciary litigation team who will generally start off with a demand letter for an accounting or copies of a trust if you've never seen the trust, stuff like that, and then potentially have to pursue it to litigation to either remove the trustee to get someone new in or to enforce the breach to the trustee, meaning the trustee took money. Now we need to get that money back into the trust, things like that. And so it's usually a fiduciary litigation specialty. Any guesstimate of a time commitment for being a special needs trustee? I would say on day one, it will seem like a lot of work because you got to get everything kind of set up. And then eventually, as in most things in life, it starts to get a little bit automated, right? And once you sort of get on autopilot, your job is a lot easier and it's a lot easier to maintain. And then you developed your routines and, you know, protocols of how often you're going to do a distribution and what for what purposes and so on and so forth. Most often family do this from a family obligatory perspective. If it's extraordinary work, depending on extraordinary, unique circumstances, maybe there's a house involved and there's a lot of work that needs to be made, then asking for a fee is super appropriate. So it's just a matter of specifically what's going on. Should you ask? I mean, I don't know if I can answer. Should you ask? Is it inappropriate to ask? No, not at all. I think it's fine to ask. Depends on the relationship with you and your mother. A lot of times these trusts as a default will have some kind of casual, reasonable compensation language in it. So it might already, you know, maybe one way to get around asking if it's awkward is just to say, can I get a draft of the special needs trust so I can ask some questions of my attorney? And then you see the document and you can see it does entitle you to reasonable comp. And then you don't maybe have to have the conversation at all. If I become a special needs trustee, what would my typical duties be? What reporting or documentation is required? So first of all, you owe a legal or fiduciary duty to act in the best interest of the beneficiary, which would be the disabled individual. And everything you do must be for the exclusive benefit of the beneficiary. Primary duty, take care of the beneficiary. Use the money for the beneficiary's benefit without disqualifying the beneficiary from the public benefits that Joey is receiving. So not to make an improper distribution, not to make distributions to Joey, but instead to pay the dentist bill versus paying Joey money to pay the dentist. Little things like that is one very important thing to do. The other is there is reporting requirement. You have to provide an accounting on an annual basis to the beneficiary or to the guardian of the beneficiary, making sure that they have a time and ability to inspect all the accounting, how the money was used, so on and so forth, so that if something is going off, they have the right to ask questions, challenge what's going on and so forth. Can special needs trust be used to take the beneficiary on vacations? Absolutely. Absolutely. What they necessarily cannot, what's a little bit more gray is, can the special needs trust be used to take the parent or the guardian on vacation with Joey? That one's a little bit more gray. That one's going to depend a little bit on the circumstances. But that is a much more riskier use of the funds. Paying for Joey to go to Disney World, no problem. Paying for the entire family to go to Disney World with Joey, problem. Could I just name my daughter without disabilities as the sole beneficiary of my life insurance policies to take care of my son with disability if she's set up to take care of him upon my passing? That's a great question.
Questions.
Yeah, it is one of my favorite questions. I'm not a big fan of that strategy. I can appreciate the simplicity of it. What I can't appreciate is how much you're willing to gamble on behalf of your son. And I do think it is a lot of potential risk. First of all, there's no guarantee your daughter will take care of your son. And I mean no offense by that. It's just there's no guarantee. Even if you believe there is a certainty to that, there are things outside of your daughter's control. For example, your daughter is driving home one day, gets in a car accident, seriously injures a family, gets in a lawsuit, gets sued, gets $1 million judgment against her. She's done nothing wrong, but just had an accident. Now the money you've left your daughter to take care of your son is now exposed to that car accident. Or what if your daughter was married and then they didn't make it and, you know, they got divorced, and the way the money was given to your daughter, she commingled those assets, and now half of it's going to your ex-son-in-law instead of the half that was being held with your daughter for your son. Or if your daughter had credit issues, or gosh, daughter had children of her own, and one of her children has a serious need. She's got all this money in the bank account, even though it was meant for her brother. Now there's a conflict, a mother's pull to help her children. What are you going to do? What's she going to do? There's just so much uncertainty as to what could happen. And it doesn't even require a bad act or a disbelief that your daughter will do the right thing or to take care of her brother in that example. So I highly encourage you never to disinherit the disabled individual. I mean, never. I mean, I do usually a judgment-free zone, but I would say I really try to advocate for folks not to disinherit, because I have seen those terrible situations happen. What would rather do is create a special needs trust and name your daughter to be the trustee or in charge of that special needs trust. So now that money is there. You could take the life insurance. You could say 50% goes to your daughter. The other 50% goes into special needs trust for your son. Name the daughter in charge of the special needs trust. Have her use it for your son. And if those bad things happen, divorce, car accident, creditor issues, any of that, they wouldn't be able to touch any of that money in that special needs trust for your son. So that's my recommendation there. Does a guardianship follow you if you move out of Missouri? Do I need to get the guardianship updated if we move to Illinois? If the ward, which is the individual adjudicated as incapacitated and disabled, the person that is why there's a need for a guardianship, if that person moves, then yes, you do, it does not follow you. You do, I mean, technically it might follow you because somebody, you could show that court order to somebody and they may accept it. But legally, you need to register that guardianship in that new county in which you moved to, in that new state. So usually you would transfer the guardianship so that they have that, and you'll want that authority one day because technically you're not supposed to be in Illinois listening to a Missouri order, or they might not listen to it. Do you need to revisit guardianships every so many years, or are they typically fine as is for the duration of the individual's life? Well, if you're talking about the guardians that you potentially name in your estate planning documents for who you would want to take care of your minor or disabled children, I think it's a common practice every 3 to 5 years, pull out your estate planning documents and make sure all the people you named in all the documents make sense to you, including the guardians. So one of the things you might need to understand is you named 75 and a 78-year-old to be your kids' guardians, and now 10 years later, they're 85 and 88, and are they really the right people to care for a 14-year-old? Potentially, I don't know. Depends on a variety of things. So you may want to revisit that. Now, if you're talking about an actual guardianship, like where one in court has already existed, then it's really a matter of whether they're capable of doing it or not. And any time that they're not capable, you can go in and ask the court to move on to someone new. How many guardians do families typically name in their estate planning document? It depends on ages too. I mean, if the brother was significantly younger, maybe that's fine. But I would say the general rule of thumb, this is a general rule. I also acknowledge not all families are built the same. Not all families have the same relationships, the same numbers. So this is meant to be a general rule, the rule of three. So you name somebody, you name a backup to that somebody, and then a backup to a backup. What if I have no one to name as the guardian of my daughter upon my passing? What do I do? That's a really great question. There's a couple of avenues to pursue. One, you can name the public administrator in the county in which you live, or which your child lives. And then they would be the one responsible for making health decisions. If you have assets in a special needs trust for that same child, you can name a trustee, and that could be a bank. So the bank can manage the money, the public administrator can make the medical decisions, and the public administrator can ask the bank for the money to pay for the services or the things like that, in addition to getting the individual and a child on public benefits. So that could be an option. Second option is there are starting to become some individual professionals that are willing to serve as guardians. If you don't want to go towards the public official, like the public administrator, which is probably overtaxed, overlabored, tired, and will not always do the complete one-on-one specialization touch, not because they're bad people, they're great people. It's just they have thousands of people that are doing this for, then you might be willing to pay for a professional guardian. Another question I think that was highlighted in the summary of this topic was powers of attorneys. When to do them? Can you do them? Well, first of all of you on this call, presumably the parents or loved ones of someone with a disability, all of you should have a power of attorney, okay? Because you yourself at one point in your life may become incapacitated. Alzheimer's, dementia, car accident, whatever. The last thing we want to do is go seek a guardianship through the court to make your own decisions. And any of you that are married thinking that you don't have to worry about it because you're married and your spouse will make those decisions, that's not the law. Even your spouse is not allowed to make your medical and financial decisions on your behalf. Heck, you could own a house jointly with your spouse. Me and my wife own our house together. If I became incapacitated tomorrow, my wife wouldn't even be able to sell the house. She has no authority to sign my name. So a power of attorney is a very effective, easy way to identify people to step into my shoes or your shoes to help make your medical and financial decisions for you in the event you're no longer capable of making those. So I think that's a very important thing to know, is that you all should get powers of attorneys, medical and financial, and name the people you want to name in order as to who's going to be making those decisions for you. As for Joey, prior to Joey turning 18, the law automatically gives the parents or the legal guardians the authority to make medical and financial decisions on behalf of their child. However, once the child becomes an adult, and that's just an age, it's got nothing to do with capability, it's got nothing to do with capacity or disability, just a number, 18. And when Joey turns 18, you have absolutely, at least legally, you're prevented from being able to make decisions for Joey. Now, if Joey authorizes it to the doctor, to the bank, then they can rely on that authorization and talk to mom and dad or dad. When your child turns 18, I think the evaluation starts of whether you need a guardian or can you do a power of attorney. Those kind of seem to be sort of the choices. And a doctor that sees and cares for Joey is a great place to start with the question of, do you believe Joey can sign and understand legal documents? If the doctor feels like Joey can understand, especially if explained properly to him, then you might want to do a power of attorney, or you still might want to do a guardian. And I'll explain the deeper analysis here in a second. But before I do that, if the doctor says, no, Joey really can't understand these documents, then you really got to stop right there and you have no choice. Guardianship's the route to go. There's a whole nother presentation that Park gives on guardianship. I don't give those. Someone else, I think, does.
We also do one on supported decision making, which helps families and individuals determine how much support an individual might need. So they might determine at that point, maybe they do need a power of attorney or a guardian or something less.
Yeah. No, great. Thank you, Ann. And I did say if the doctor thought Joey could understand documents, then you might choose versus the other option. You really got to go down this one route. Well, why would you choose one over the other? if I were to boil it down to one statement, one question, it's a lot more complicated than that. But if I were to just boil it down to one, in my opinion, throughout all the clients we've represented, it usually boils down to this one question, which is, what are Joey's center of influence is like? If Joey is susceptible for being manipulated or duped into signing something or agreeing to something, or he could be easily influenced to co-sign a loan or a credit card application or do things that aren't necessarily the most prudent choice, and there's the center of influence that might get him to do those things, I generally see people then gravitate to the guardianship route. The reason being, you're going to get a court order that says he's not capable of agreeing to those things. So when he does go off and sign that loan, or he goes and signs that credit card application, or he gives some money or does something, you show the court order and it all erases. It all gets unwound easy. And if you think that that is a big thing, that Joey's easily influenced or persuaded or gullible or, you know, whatever, then that's a very potential protective move. If you feel comfort in the environment and that you've created your own version of a plastic bubble around Joey, where you feel safe that those predators, for lack of a better word, are not going to trick Joey into doing something, then moving down the power of attorney route might be a softer, easier step to explore. So that's just kind of my practical insight. That's me not being a lawyer for a moment, where I see how I see it play out. The most common reason for people to not do guardianships are usually based on things that are not even true. I'm not going to do a guardianship for Joey because I am not going to let him not be able to vote. That's not true. I don't want him to never be able to drive. That's not true. I don't want him to ever not have a job. Not true. I don't want him to never be able to get married. Not true. I want him to have kids. Not true. But these are many reasons people tell me why they don't want to ever do a guardianship. They're usually all reasons that aren't true. They just based it on Googling or talking to a friend or whatever. So just something to be mindful for. I started by saying, who all should you have in your world that could help you on the advisory team, so to speak, that you should probably consider? And that is some sort of potential financial advisor. And there's bandwidth advisors for a variety of things. Larger net worth, smaller net worth, types of professions, you know, industries, whatever. And so, you know, again, trying to seek financial advisors is a great idea, strategy. I think one area that is somewhat important, no one's most popular subject, is how can the world of life insurance be used? I'm an attorney, not a life insurance guy. I'm truly objective here. I do think there's a magical role for life insurance when you're with families, with Joey's, with loved ones with disabilities. Especially when you have public benefits and you can maybe get public benefits, you could shift those public benefits to mom and dad, you know, to hold, and then mom and dad uses that public benefit money to buy life insurance that creates a nest egg or a death benefit for Joey. And then that goes in a special needs trust so it doesn't disqualify him. And, you know, a couple hundred thousand dollars to even a half a million if you're relatively healthy might get paid for from just the government funding. So it's a great strategy for how you could get a bigger chunk of money for Joey, where you're not as stressed out about planning for your own retirement and then also planning for your child's retirement. And really, you may do that with that just by optimizing public benefit you're getting from SSI. We won't go into that strategy per se, but that's exactly why a special needs planning person needs to be on your team. And then a financial advisor person that knows what they're doing is on your team, because you may be able to create wealth where you thought you could not, and how. And it's remarkable when we put that strategy in place for our families. I think a third advisor in the world of advisors, maybe also for some kind of accounting help. If you don't already have someone that's doing your tax returns, a lot of times special needs trusts that already have assets in it require a separate tax return, income tax return. It's called a Form 1041. And that is not as easy to do on, and like you might be able to do your own 1040 individual tax return. 1041s are a little bit more complicated. And so an accounting firm might be a good add-on to your team of people to help you. I think getting yourself integrated to organizations like ARC is very critical, in my opinion, because they have some of the best resources and people to direct you to other resources. And I think that's important to get engaged and involved in that front. And lastly, depending on your child's level of disability, you might need sort of a caseworker, someone that can be an advocate for Joey in how best to orchestrate public benefits and so on and so forth. A special needs planner will be able to do a lot of that as well, but a caseworker or a regional office case manager or someone in that nature, they live in the system, and they are going to be great advocates for you as well.
I think you named some good ones, you know, the attorney, a caseworker or social worker or advocate type of person, and the financial planner are good people to have on your team. And then depending on the needs of the individual, you may have some other folks on your team. You may have therapists or behavior specialists or other people, but those would be some of the key people to have on your family team. Thank you all for being here this evening.
Thanks, everybody. Appreciate it.